Future Station cruise. With the supplies on board Atlantis, the International Space Station will be in good shape through all of 2012, when U.S. commercial companies under contract with NASA are expected to begin resupply flights to the space station. Atlantis' crew also is bringing an experiment called the Robotic Refueling Mission, which we put on the station's exterior during the next 2 years, together with the Canadian Dexter robotic arm. We'll test tools, technology, and techniques to robotically refuel space, in particular satellites, including those that were never intended to be refueled while they're in space. The crew also will return to Earth a failed space station cooling system ammonia pump, and the flight also has one spacewalk while Atlantis is docked at the space station, but it'll be carried out by the two NASA astronauts aboard the International Space Station right now and supported by the Atlantis' crew members. Looking at the STS-135 mission by the numbers, this is the 135th shuttle flight and the 37th shuttle mission to the International Space Station. This will be Atlantis' 33rd mission overall, and obviously, yes, its final flight. Currently, STS-135 is a 12-day flight, but with a launch this morning, and once Atlantis gets to the space station and managers can assess how well the crew has been conserving the cryogenic reactants inside the shuttle's three electricity-producing fuel cells, they may add a day of docked operations to the mission, so that could put landing back here at the Kennedy Space Center either on July 20th, a little after 7 a.m. Eastern, or July 21st, a little after 6 a.m. Eastern. Once Atlantis does safely return to the Kennedy Space Center, it will begin a slow deservicing process and preparation to be eventually put on public display. And teams won't have very far to take Atlantis, just down the road to Kennedy Space Center's visitor complex, which has the honor of being able to display Atlantis, the only space shuttle NASA will keep. Discovery is going to the Smithsonian outside Washington, D.C., and the Endeavour is going to the California Science Center in Los Angeles. NASA will transport the shuttles to their respective public display sites starting next spring. So this will be the last flight for Atlantis, which was the fourth space shuttle in NASA's fleet, and it made its first maiden voyage almost 26 years ago. Shortly, now that we're in stable replenish and we've done with the fueling process for Atlantis, the closeout crew and final inspection teams will be dispatched to Launch Pad 39 to begin their respective jobs. Closeout crew goes to the pad's white room, and it's the access area to the hatch for Atlantis, where the astronauts will board the shuttle. And this 7-person crew will help secure the astronauts into the shuttle and then close Atlantis' hatch. The 7-person final inspection team, which is also known as the ICE team, will go to the pad surface to begin its inspections. Those team members provide the direct eye contact with the shuttle to make sure things aren't amiss. And the group actually is part of a much larger team looking very closely at the shuttle. So let us take a look now at all the imagery activities that will go into this morning's final space shuttle launch.
2, 1, booster ignition, and the final liftoff of Discovery.
Perhaps one of the most impressive images is that of a space shuttle lifting off the launch pad, riding plumes of bright orange flames. But more than just providing an impressive sight, shuttle images play a critical role in launch safety. Each successful launch depends heavily on still and video images that allow the launch team to closely scrutinize the spacecraft both before and during liftoff. Long before the main engines fire and the solid rocket boosters ignite, the entire shuttle stack has been thoroughly photographed and continually monitored by TV cameras as the countdown clock ticks down. Members of a group called the Final Inspection Team play a key role, providing the imagery directly from the launch pad and analysis from the Launch Control Center.
The images we take on the Final Inspection Team are sent back to the LCC. When we give the report to the Mission Management Team and to the Launch Director, to the SPE, they can look at our imagery, and in particular ones we single out, and tell them that we know there's a problem here. They can do analysis of their own on those images.
The team members can identify and photograph problems that might go undetected without their on-the-spot inspection. But the launch director and his team aren't limited to just images from the inspection team.
In the LCC, we have the ISOFROST console, and we continuously monitor upward to 135 different camera locations. Those assets are controlled by NASA and other contractors, some as far as, I believe, close to 20 miles south and 20 miles north of the launch complex. And some of these assets are basically large telescopes, and they will be able to film the orbiter several minutes into its flight profile. We also have about 60 cameras within the actual perimeter of the launch pad. Some are various assets, some are infrared, some are HD, some are standard, some are at higher speed and slower speed. A lot of them are at about the 400 frames per second, so we can catch a very, very slow behavioral aspect of each vehicle component. Because some components we want to watch how they work the moment they're supposed to go to work, and we'll see them frame by frame. We watch them frame by frame.
So as the final space shuttle pierces the sky over NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida, both technology and trained eyes will once again be keenly focused to ensure a safe and successful mission.
And we're back now live looking at Space Shuttle Atlantis on Launch Pad 39A, where it is fully fueled for its launch attempt this morning. Again, we started the tanking process on time at 2:01 a.m. Eastern and wrapped up the tanking process slightly ahead of schedule at 4:58 a.m. Eastern. See from this shot in the distance the xenon lights bathing the shuttle in its launch pad, and on the you can also see fire at the launch pad, which of course is okay because that's fire from the flare stack, which is burning off the excess hydrogen gas that comes from the external tank during the tanking process. Earlier this evening, before the tanking meeting at 1:30 this morning, as we were driving in, there was a large cloud deck that was over the pad, and these xenon lights were illuminated, casting shadows on those clouds. Since then, the forecast has, although it's remained at 30% for favorable conditions at launch time, the overnight hours have been very benign, and we've had no issues at all with the weather, no lightning, unlike what we had yesterday, and no real weather to speak of. The concern is that around mid-morning, with the sun heating the Florida landscape, we'll get these thunderstorms and rain. Could be around the Kennedy Space Center. And that's why we have only a 30% chance of having good weather. But based on the conditions they've seen overnight, the launch team has been guardedly optimistic. While the forecast is obviously not great, as NASA likes to say, it's been trending in the right direction. The closeout crew and final inspection team are making their way up to the launch pad surface now to begin their respective jobs. The final inspection team will begin on the pad surface and start its inspections, and of course the closeout crew will head to the white room to start preparing it and the hatch and interior parts of the shuttle's flight deck and mid-deck for when the astronauts will arrive around 8 o'clock this morning. So again, the launch team is not working any issues that would prevent us from launching on time at 11:26 a.m. Eastern. We currently have 2 hours, 18 minutes, and 5 seconds remaining in this built-in hold. So at T-minus 3 hours in holding, this is Shuttle Launch Control.